Well, good evening, Saints. We thank you once again for another beautiful Wednesday night Bible study. My name is Elder Kyle Page, and on behalf of Macedonia Church here in all Connecticut, we welcome you. Also, we give honor to our pastor, Pastor DeWitt Stevens Jr., and his assistant pastor, Elder Michael Rumble. We just are happy just one more time just to come and just dive into the Word of God. Amen. So at this time, let us go into prayer. Is there one that would like to lead us out in prayer tonight? There's one that would like to take the time to usher us into the presence of God. Let me go with Sister Michelle. Do we have sound?
We glorify your name, magnify your name. There's no one like you nowhere. Oh God, we thank you, God, because you're righteous. We thank you, oh Lord, because, oh God, you kept us and you never fail. Lord, have your mighty way all night long. Let the blood of the Lamb prevail in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we thank you for time. We thank you for your word that you're about to bring forth. Let it fall on your ground that we may grow thereby. Anoint the teacher in the name of Jesus. We thank you. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. I know that was a little difficult trying to hear her come in. Can I just get one more person just to come on? Just give me just a test just to make sure that I'm good here. Sister Nikki, why don't you just come on for a second? Just say something.
Elder Kyle, can you hear me?
Absolutely. Perfect. Perfect. So just give us another short prayer. Tag team with Sister Michelle and just give us a short prayer that we all can hear.
Go ahead. Matthew wants to say something. Go ahead and pray, Matt.
God, I thank you for this day and I love everybody. And I love Jesus and I can help everybody so nobody don't get sick and don't go to heaven and nobody don't get sick and everybody can get food and breakfast
and look on the Bible study in the precious powerful name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen. That's beautiful. Thank you so much, Sister Nikki, little brother Matthew, and Sister Michelle. We thank you so much. At this time, we're going to keep moving forward. We're going to ask Sister Armstead to come on and read the lesson text for us.
Good evening. I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him. But the just shall live by his faith. Yea, also, because he transgresseth by wine, he is a proud man, neither keepeth at home who enlargeth his desire as hell, and is as death, and cannot be satisfied, but gathereth unto him all nations, and heapeth unto him all people. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines. The labor of the olive shall fail, and the fields shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stalls. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and he will make my feet like hinds' feet. And he will make me to walk upon my high places, to the chief singer on my string instruments. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy word.
Amen. Thank you so much for reading that. I just thought it was just, it's not coincidence. As we know, nothing is by coincidence in our faith. But I thank God, because today in the Daily Bread, for those of us that saw it, actually the reading for the Daily Bread actually is 2 Kings 22. And I believe it's 1 through 12 or 1 through 13. So our reference scriptures actually picks up where they left off today. So just that may just be a little plug for somebody who may want to just get a good Bible study, a little feed your soul a little bit before you go to bed tonight. 2 Kings chapter 22. These other related scriptures were excellent to read. We're not going to read them tonight, but hopefully you had a chance. And if not, it really ties into the lesson, Psalms 36, as you can see on the screen, 1 through 12, Galatians chapter 3, 10 through 14. And then lastly, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 4 through 11. So as you, those of us that studied this lesson, we all know that this is an exciting lesson and that it's jam-packed. You had to really do a little bit of digging. And we have a treat for you tonight. Hopefully you can figure out what that treat is that we have for you by the end of this service. I'll check in later to see if you was able to figure out what that treat is. But we have a treat for you tonight. Now, moving right along. Today's aim is to understand how can we bring ourselves to praise the Lord, even in the midst of a trial, and how he can still use our ministry even while we are suffering. We're going to talk a little bit about that tonight, praising God in the midst of times of suffering. The principle is to demonstrate that suffering ultimately accomplishes God's good purposes. And then application is to help Christians who suffer understand and access God's resources for enduring. By way of a short, brief introduction, let us look at some of these. God's ways and thoughts are as high as above those men as the heavens are higher than the earth. Habakkuk prophesied a dark future for his nation. Let me just say this while I'm thinking about it. Those of us that looked up how to pronounce Habakkuk, there's actually two pronunciations for the way, you know, it's said to pronounce it. It could be pronounced Habakkuk or it could be pronounced Habakkuk. That was the two that I saw. But I'm going with Habakkuk. That's easy. God revealed that Judah would be disciplined for his sin by the Chaldeans or the Babylonians. He strongly believed in social justice. Habakkuk couldn't understand how God could let the Jews sin and then be punished by the Chaldeans, who were even more sinful than his people. The prophet had to learn to put his personal trust in God for salvation and leave all matters in the hands of the Lord. So at this time, I'm going to ask Brother Tyler, to come on and read this verse of scripture for us, Romans 8 and 28. Tyler, are you there?
Yep. Yeah. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose.
Amen. Can you read that one more time for me?
And
actually,
we know.
Actually, can you read it two more times for the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost?
And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. And we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose.
Amen. Thank you so much. And you actually was anointed reading it too. So I'm really grateful for that and really could appreciate that. Also, I use a little psychology on you. They say once a person reads something two or three times, it'll stay in their heart and their mind. So hopefully this one scripture will carry you throughout the rest of your life. It's one of my favorites. But thank you so much. So, question on the floor tonight. Who is Habakkuk? Who is Habakkuk? Who is he? Does anybody take the time to find out who he is? Sister Angela McFarlane.
Okay, we know that he is the author of this book, Habakkuk, and it's the eighth book of the 12 minor prophets. And I think he was around 605, 608 BC, sometime around that area.
Excellent. I'll just add to that, there's no record of his place of birth or ancestry. He was a poet. I'm not sure if you said that, you might have. His hatred of sin caused him to cry out to God for judgment. He was a man who feared the Lord. That's very important because the Bible says in Proverbs that the fear of the Lord is to hate all evil, pride, and arrogance. And this particular study deals a lot with pride, and we're going to take a little bit of time to dive into that as well. And it goes on to say that the fear of the Lord is also to hate the evil way and a forward mouth, and that's kind of the life that we saw Habakkuk portray. Who else is he? Sister Sabrina.
His purpose of this whole entire book was to show that God is still in control of the world despite of their apparent triumph of the evil. And I just feel like this today is about this book right here is talking about the day, even though this is years ago, 586 it was. Right now, when I read this, it was so prevalent to what is going on in our nation today.
Amen. I agree 100%. And we're going to talk about that. Brother Ricky, Elder Wilkes, Sister Mary, Sister Crystal, and Sister Quanah, we'll get your hands in that order. Brother Ricky?
Yes. It was very little that was pretty much that we know about Habakkuk. We do know he was one of the minor prophets that prophesied about the Babylonians and the destruction of Jerusalem.
Excellent. Elder Wilkes?
As Ricky said, and someone else said, he's one of the minor prophets, and that's just because his book is not as extensive or as long as some of the other books as the major prophets. So it doesn't take away from the word that he was given or from his character or his role. It's just that his book was not as long, so that's why he's called a minor prophet.
Excellent. Sister Mary?
And I also read that he was not only a prophet, he was a skilled poet, like what we read at the end of this scripture text. It was like sort of like a psalm. So he wrote poems, and he also prophesied right before they went into the Babylonian captivity to the kingdom of Judah, and his contemporaries were like Jeremiah and Zephaniah and them.
Excellent. Sister Quanah, and then lastly, Sister Crystal.
Yeah, I was reading that he must have had a really deep relationship with God, because his whole books was just a conversation between him and God, where he was being so real with God and just answering, you know, asking questions. So he had a really deep relationship with God.
Excellent. Excellent. That, as you can see, I put that right on the screen. That's exactly where I was going when everybody finished. Sister Crystal.
Okay. It was said, but I just want to add, his book, it was unique in that he didn't prophesy to the people, which most of the prophets do that. It was a dialogue between he and God. Generally, prophets prophesy to the people, but it was a dialogue between God, he and God.
Amen. Perfect. Perfect segue into I was going next, Sister Crystal. Thank you so much. He was a prophet who believed in prayer. Amen. And he was a man who believed that a woman of God could pray and God would answer. So my question for you tonight is, who still believes in the power of prayer? I mean, you don't have to raise your hand. I mean, I'll take a hand. But who still believes in the power of prayer? As we heard, he was a man of faith. He believed that he could go and have a conversation with the Lord and God will answer. And if there's ever a time, as we heard Sister Sabrina say, today is that day where we still need to be able to call on God and get an answer. Amen? Amen. So the structure of the book. Chapter 1 through 4 begins with a cry of woe. Injustice is rampant. The righteous are acquitted, the righteous meaning the acquitted and the blameless are surrounded by the wicked, meaning the guilty. The covenant law is no longer impartially applied here in this book. The lack of justice results in strife and trouble and violence, as we're seeing in this day and time, as we just heard. God doesn't seem to care about the plight of his people. That's how he was kind of feeling. And he was wondering why God was allowing this to happen. So he was a man who sought answers. He saw a dying world and it broke his heart. He had, in other words, he had the burden of the Lord. Amen. He couldn't understand why there was evil in this world. I mean, why it was even being allowed to happen to God's people even the more, nor why the wicked seemed to be winning. He just could not wrap his head around that. So he took his complaints to God in a series of questions. Now, what did that look like? Some theologians, they call it the question and answer technique. So the question I want to propose to you tonight, how many of you, when you were growing up, you were taught that you were not supposed to question God? Is there anybody that was taught other than myself that you shouldn't question God? Just out of curiosity. If not, I don't want you to make anything up. I'll just dive right into that. Sister Myra, I'll go ahead.
Yes, I was told by my mom you should not question God, because whatever he decides to do is always going to be correct, no matter what. So in his infinite glory, we have to just leave it in his hands and go with it. Just don't question him, because he's not to be questioned.
Sister Amanda, and then Sister Maria Perry.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
So we grew up Catholic, and I was also taught that if you question God, it was like disrespectful.
Wow. Sister Maria Perry.
I was raised in a Pentecostal church, so I didn't have a personal relationship with God. I just did routine and went to church a few times a week. So I didn't know him personally. I just went to church. So I didn't know him to be my friend, and I just knew not to question anything he did. And I was just taught to just walk in his ways.
Okay, thank you so much. I think the way you said that, it almost appeared to like that Pentecostals don't have a relationship with God. But I know that's not what you're saying, but it just could appear that way. So I just wanted to let's let you know that. Sister Jennifer.
Yes, I was taught that too by just random people. It wasn't anyone like specific, but it just perplexed me because I'm like, well, I'm not questioning God in a sense of disrespect. I just have a question. So I'm looking for understanding. So you're telling me if I don't understand something, I can't go to him. It was how, and they probably didn't mean it that way, but it was how it was presented to me. I can't go to God about nothing. I have to accept it is what it is. And then ask that. And it just left me like, well, I don't know what to do. How can I have a relationship with God if we can't have a conversation? It just left me in the dark.
Amen. Yeah, and for myself, you know, now I'm about to do what I just said Maria did. But growing up in a Baptist church, you know, it was said. I literally heard it. That's why I didn't do it, or I didn't think I could do it. That you weren't supposed to question God. You were just supposed to accept whatever happened. So at the age of 8 years old, as I shared so many times, my father died. And I can remember coming home from school that afternoon, seeing walking into a house full of people gathered around my mother and to look in my mother's eyes and then be told that my father had unexpectedly passed. And I remember walking into his bedroom and sitting on their bed, just confused. I couldn't ask God. I didn't cry. I showed no emotion. And that always bothered me. That always bothered me for two reasons. That I didn't cry because I love my father to death and God knows he loved me. And every afternoon I made his lunch before he went to his second job. So this was a very traumatizing situation for an eight-year-old to come home to. And I sat on that bed and then I remember going outside still wanting to ask God, but didn't feel that I could. So now you got years of a young man growing into adulthood full of questions and anger due to the loss of his father, which led me in a direction of a life of running the streets and fighting. And every time I drank, it came out, I was fighting. And then I learned that once I got saved, that was the reason why I got into so much trouble, because of the death of my father and the buildup of the pain that would come out due to the alcohol. But I learned later as I began, as somebody said tonight, that I can have a relationship with God and it's okay to question God. And that's what Habakkuk is teaching us in this lesson, that it's okay to talk to our God. It's okay to have a two-way dialogue where I can come to him and talk to him and he can come to me and talk back to me. That's a beautiful thing, because that's really what separates us from the other religions. As I say all the time, they don't feel that God speaks. They feel that they just go through a ritual, utter prayers, and then it just comes to a complete halt. That's it. And they do that ritually every single day. But we have a God that we can come to. We can ask him questions. He'll be willing to answer our questions back. And it's just a beautiful thing. And that's where we talk about having that personal relationship with God. Sister Janine and Mother Millie.
Yeah, I think you basically just said exactly what I was going to say. On the contrary, it's more or less the position of the heart and the intent that you're questioning God with, because I believe questioning God can be an act of faith, right? We take our questions to God. Basically, it's just a sign that you believe he has the answer. So it's more or less having the perfect approach in that questioning him.
Amen. Good. Sister Millie?
This book reminds me, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, this book reminds me of Job when he was wrestling with why stuff was happening to him. And the name of Habakkuk means he that embraces, a wrestler.
Yeah.
So Habakkuk is, I never thought it was so interesting, but it is for today, like Sabrina said. Bye.
That's awesome. Thank you so much. And both of you gave me a chance to regroup because I feel like the moment I was in what Elder Rumble did to us on Sunday, now I just did it to myself, getting myself all emotional up here 40-something years later. But that's just life. It's real. Death is real. And we have to be able to learn and grow and get through it. But it is a day-to-day step, and sometimes it's a lifelong journey. But here we are. How many of you know I got that? Let's move on. So the lesson background, the prophet could not understand why God would have been silent and done nothing about Judah's wickedness. And you may be wondering why it appears God has been silent with the wickedness we see in our days. Anybody thought about, does it appear that God appears to be silent with all that we see on the news every single day in other nations and government and our local communities? Anybody have any thoughts on that? Does it appear that God has been silent to you? Just out of curiosity. And if not, we'll move on. Sister Sabrina and Sister Michelle.
It does at times. It's like the laws and the political things that's going on. I think it's kind of like when we had a victory and a great feat with the Roe versus Wade. Now they're making sure with the LGBT community that the marriage and stuff is like a counteract with that. Everything is counteracted. But what we have a victory as Christians, we've been praying for a long time. And now it's like the pride of politicians and people in that authority at that level has lost God, and they're just trying to do everything contrary to what God is telling. So then you think when you pray, it's like, God, we got this great feat with Roe versus Wade. Now we have to, continue to pray and push back the gates of, what the enemy's trying to do, because it feels like it sometimes. You're praying, and sometimes it seems like it gets worse before it gets better.
Amen. Good. Thank you for sharing. Sister Michelle?
Yes, amen. Hopefully you can hear me more clearly. Yes, praise God. When you asked the question, the scripture came to my spirit immediately, how God is not slack concerning his promise, as some may deem him as slack, but that he's long-suffering, simply because he's a God that no one would perish, but that all men would come to repentance. So no matter how evil a person is, God always extends the extent of every measure of grace and mercy that he has allotted for every individual. So God wishes that everyone would turn from their evil way.
Amen. Thank you so much. So now we're about to dive right into where the lesson began. We see that Habakkuk wanted to know how God could use a more wicked nation to discipline Judah. He awaits an answer from God. So let's go right into a question here. The prophet anticipation, waiting to hear from the Lord. What problem did Habakkuk have with God's use of the Chaldeans to discipline Judah? Let's go with Sister Sabrina.
Well, at this time, when you think about the conversation from chapter 1 and the back and forth with him, he just was in distress, and what the word says is by the wickedness of the people. He couldn't understand why God would go so far as the silence, and like we talked about. But then it goes back, it says, why would you put somebody as wicked as a nation who has so much pride and give them the credit? Like, he had the relationship with God, like, I want you to get the credit. Like, it's all about you right now. But it was like God had a bigger plan. And sometimes those questions that we ask, we look in our finite mind, we have just a little bit of the story, but God has a bigger picture. Even with this, the Chaldeans, he knew what he was going to do. But when we look at it with our finite minds as humans, it just never makes sense. So he couldn't believe, why would you put somebody in and get the pride? We're going to give you the glory. Like, he embraced God and he praised God. Like the title said, he just couldn't understand it.
Excellent. So question number two, in what sense was the Old Testament prophet's watchman? Sister Maria and then Brother Dean.
God had instructed Habakkuk to write the vision and make it plain. The revelation was for an appointed time and would not happen immediately. Watchmen are often given visions and dreams, and a word can be set for a specific time to encourage or warn. But they are to be like soldiers posted at a point of trust waiting for important news. Oftentimes promises require patience, and we must have faith and be hopeful and trust in his timing.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Brother Dean, Minister Dean.
pretty much said a lot of what I said. One of the things, as watchmen, prophets were also called to warn wicked people of judgment and destruction. I had two scriptures when I was researching that went really good with that was Ezekiel 33 and 7 and Hosea 9 and 8.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that. So moving right along. Now here we are with the revelations of certainty. Question number 3 in your book. What did God instruct Habakkuk to do with the vision? Let's go with Sister Angel.
He wanted him to write it down, like chisel it out on stone.
All right. I guess everybody answered that. So I put inscribing on the tablets was a permanent reminder and a witness. The vision will not tarry, but is for a set time. Any thoughts on that? Inscribing it on the vision of tablets. What would be the opposite of that? Does that make sense? That question makes sense? If it wasn't written, what would be the opposite of that? Let me go with Sister Perdue.
I would believe if it wasn't written down, the people would be so easy to forget the importance of it and what God was trying to convey to them. So that's why I believe he asked them to write it down. So it wasn't just for the present generation, but for the generations to come afterwards. It would be a permanent reminder that the vision was yet tarrying, but they will be fulfilled at his appointed time.
Excellent. Elder Stanrod, and this is Michelle.
Yeah, one of the reasons also because in times of trials and calamity, you know, you could lose hope, but God wanted the vision to be written down so that they could know that God had it all in control and that a better end was coming in spite of, you know, what the Babylonians were going to do. So God, you know, it's easy. It's almost like, you know, even with Paul told Timothy to fight a good warfare with the word that's went forward on his life. Because sometimes if you don't remember the promises of God, you can get discouraged. But having it written down, it causes you to run and to have faith.
Beautiful. Sister Michelle?
Oh, Elder Stimrod pretty much said what I was going to say.
Amen. Thank you so much. So, for the vision is yet for a point of time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. The phrase for the vision is yet for a point of time means the fulfillment of the vision. Prophecy would occur at a time designated by the Lord. What do you think about that? I mean, in his day, in our day, within the House of Macedonia, within maybe your nonprofit organization, what's your thoughts on that? Brother Ricky.
All right, Elder Kyle. So I was reading, when I was studying this lesson, this is literally, you know, how I kind of got out of it. I was translated in the New Living Translation, and I was reading that same verse, and it says, write my answer plainly on tablets so that a runner can carry the correct message to others. This vision is for a future time. It describes the end, it will be fulfilled. And I really didn't understand the first part, and I'm like, write my answer plainly on tablets. And pretty much Habakkuk had a lot of questions for God, you know, the whole first chapter, you know, and even into the second, going into the second, he was questioning God. So pretty much God was just saying, listen, this is my answer. And a lot of times we're given prophetic words, years in the past, and I'll be one to say sometimes you forget what God said that, you know, is going to happen in the future. So he was pretty much just telling him, listen, this vision is not for right now. What you're about to write is not for right now, but this will happen, you know, in the future time. So everything that God was going to tell Habakkuk, it was going to describe the end and what will happen. So in this way, if any of them, you know, Judah or Habakkuk ever forgot, they can look back at the tablets and just pretty much see what God has said.
Excellent and well said. And you just made me think about a few things. One, with this COVID, as some of you already know, there's long-term effects, what they call the fog, which means that a lot of people don't currently have or may experience a period of time where they don't have the memory that they used to have. They can't remember certain things once they've been affected by the COVID virus. So I would encourage everybody to write everything down now, especially if you've been through the COVID bout. I get questions sometimes. People come to me, you remember that dream? I said, I don't remember. Then some of us are just getting older too. I mean, let's just be real here. So I would encourage all of us to just write down everything these days and rehearse what the Lord is saying. Sister Sonya, Sister Myra, Sister Shirley.
I think also, whether you relate it to then or now, when he says to write it down on tablets, it became a permanent document for validation and reference. So that, you know, like you said, how when we write prophecies down, if you look back at the prophecy, the way it was written, then you rehearse it. And when it gets fulfilled, it's a validation of the promise. So it's and what he was doing by writing it, he was validating it's going to happen. And almost like if I could envision it, you can look on them tablets and you're going to see based on when it was prophesied that it truly came to pass. So writing it down was also, I think, look, for me, like in where we are. Pastor, I remember pastors gave us the booklet with the church. He wrote the promise down that God gave him. And then when it happened, literally verbatim, word for word, it was fulfillment of the promise of God. Good or bad, but it was the fulfillment of the promise of God.
Amen. Amen. Sister Myra?
Yes, you know, in my day, we didn't have microwaves and air fryers and all these things that are so quick to cook. And so we're so impatient. We just want it fast, 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 no matter what. And now it's like you had to put it in the oven or put it on top of the stove. But now we don't have to do that. So we've become an impatient group of people. So everything has to be quick and fast and in a hurry. And we've grown to not learn how to be patient and wait on the Lord, no matter what. He will not fail us. He will not let us down. He's always there, and his timing is always right on time. That's my view.
Amen. I agree. Shirley Stanrod, we are last. Let me get to Curtis. Shirley's having a little technical difficulty. Curtis?
Okay. Also, with the watchtower, a prophet was standing in the watchtower and so it being a prophet. And the prophet would stand in the watchtower and would look down throughout the field. And he has the ability to see what's coming up the road.
Hey, brother Curtis, let me interrupt you for a second. You're just a little muffled. So I'm not sure what that's all about. You may want to go off and come back. I'll get you.
Okay, Jim.
Nah, you're still a little muffled. Just go. I'll give you third try. Nah, yeah, you got to go back out and come in. So what God was about to reveal concerning Judah's restoration and Babylon defeat wouldn't happen immediately. The captivity had to take place first, and people needed a written record to remind them that they would be delivered and their captives would be judged. The phrase, "but at the end shall speak and not lie," means the prophecy eagerly looks forward to the time of its fulfillment. But in the meantime, it will not deceive those who read it. So God knew that they would need something that they would need to look to and have in hand, that it will remind them even during the tough times. A lot of times when we're in the midst of the storm, it's hard to remember. It's hard to hear the scriptures come up in your spirit. You got to be in a real a quiet place sometimes to really be reminded of what the Lord already has said or what you already know to be the truth. So a lot of times it's good to have things written down. The last part of that verse says, though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. The word tarry means here to linger. When God says, though it tarry, he was saying that it may appear that the fulfillment of the prophecy may be taken a long time. But even so, the people were commanded to wait for it, because it will surely come. God is not a man that he should lie. Neither the son of man that he should repent. It will not tarry. This indicates that the fulfillment of God's message or prophecy may be longer than many expected, causing them to lose hope. And we've seen that. We've seen that in our day. We've seen that throughout our times, right? Where there's some that just grew faint. They no longer wanted to wait for what God had promised, whether that corporately was a corporate promise or even for some a personal promise. They forfeited it. So, but we must remember that God doesn't work on our schedule, and everything he does happens at the right time. That's a very key point right there. I want to take my time and talk about. Remember that he doesn't work on our schedule. Elder Wilkes preached a message talking about time, and he broke that thing down in that message that he taught. Everything does happen at the right time. It will not tarry or take longer than God determines. So Hear what the Lord is saying. It's going to happen at the God knows, and heaven knows that there's an appointed time for everything to take place that he has spoken. Elder Stanrod.
Yeah, look, I think about the vision we have about revival. Sometimes we just look at, you know, our presence surrounding Macedonia and what we believe in the Lord for. But if it's a worldwide revival, then in different parts of the world, puzzles have to come together. Things have to be in place so that God move. And just like when Israel were in captivity, you know, God said the iniquity of the Amorites weren't ripe yet for judgment. So when it was ripe, then God brought them out, you know. So now God have things with different nations and, you know, things have to be in place. You know, when it comes, the prayers have been going up. God have a set time. And I still believe the word of the Lord.
Amen. And while you were talking about that, it made me think about how some have shared they've gone on extended fast. And they were just certain and confident that once they came off that fast, the vision was going to take place. The word of the Lord would be fulfilled. But they found that everything still, we can't hurry God. There's a time he has in place. As you just said, he has to bring some things together and we just can't hurry him. We just have to wait. So the question becomes, I think here is the question. Where is it? We'll wait for that. We'll wait for that. So the scripture says, for you have need of patience that after you have done the will of God, you might receive the promise. For yet a little while, he that shall come will come. That's encouraging news. And will not tarry. So, a personal promise I have titled here. It says it can also pertain to something promised personally by the Lord to an individual, but long delayed. Even though delayed, it is not forgotten, but is actually for an appointed time. So, reiterating what we've been saying for the last few minutes. Any thoughts on that before we move on? If not, I got a question for you. And here goes the question. Why is it difficult for people to wait for what God foretold? Sister Tanea.
Can you hear me, Elder Kyle?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Uh-huh. When you talked to me on, I think it was Sunday, and you asked me to pick a question, I meditated long and hard about this question because I didn't know what I was getting myself into. But as I meditated, God led me to Pastor Joe Sweet, who really expounded on waiting on God. And he brought up the fact that Joseph, he received a word from the Lord through a vision and a dream. And Joseph might have thought that maybe he was going to receive what God had given him right away. But he had no idea that it was for a future date, that God needed to bring him through suffering and trials and testings so that he could prepare him to receive the fullness of what God had given him or was going to give him a great position in Egypt. And he would be like the main person that was going to help save the whole world because everyone would come to Egypt. But had he given him that promise when he was young in his pride, it would not have benefited God and given him glory. And it would have just increased Joseph's pride because he shouldn't have shared maybe that dream because it angered his brothers. So like go to now, like with our pastor, he's given him a vision and a promise 40 years ago. Had he given him that now, when he gave it to him, he probably wouldn't have been in the right space. He wouldn't have been ready for it. But because God brought him through suffering and trials and all these things, he peeled back layer after layer after layer so that when the appointed time comes, pastor is well ready to receive the fullness of what God has promised. That's how God gave it to me.
Wow. Yeah. And the spirit of the Lord bears witness to that. That's beautiful. And you let the cat out of the bag too, Sister Tanea. We got Sister Jennifer and Sister Mary, and then we'll get these hands. Just leave them up there. We'll get your hands because we want to hear what you have to say. It's a very important point.
Yeah, that was an amazing point, what Sister Tanea was saying. And I just look at it personally for myself. I lose hope sometimes when I would receive words, because at that moment, as I'm receiving a prophecy or some, God has given me something, speaking something over my life, I'm thinking that it's going to happen immediately. But you had mentioned it before, what it said in our Sunday school lesson. However, God does not operate on a human schedule, but he always does what he does always happens at the right time. And I had learned, wisdom shared with me that waiting is a good thing, because during my waiting, I'm glad I didn't go ahead of myself. I would have done myself a disservice, and also the people, souls that I'm responsible for. I heard Sister Merle say this one time, you have to like go through the waiting process and be ready. It's like you're going, if you're trying to go before everything is happening, it's like you're going as uncooked meat, and people get sick if you eat meat that is not cooked. You know what I mean? Absolutely. So I'm like, God, I just like what Tanea said, is like layers had to be pulled back. There was a process that I had to go through. I had to mature a little bit more. And I thank God for the waiting, because it just made me so much better than I was when the prophecy was given to me in the first place.
Beautiful. And man, you feel the anointing on your answers that you both have given so far. And there's one word that I could sum up in both of your answers so far. It's process. It's process. Sister Mary.
And also it's what we do in the waiting, that, you know, if we wait in faith, if we're not waiting in faith, we get anxious. If we're not abiding in the word and spending time with God in prayer, the waiting becomes long and tedious. So it depends on what we do in the waiting. And it just says, you know, just to just abide in the word, just stay in the word, because as soon as you get off the word and get off prayer, here comes the devil reminding you of, you know, the promise that has not come to pass. So you just have to spend time in the word and in prayer and in the presence of God. And that just helps as you go through the waiting in him.
Amen. You guys are ministering. Walter.
Yeah, I'm in total agreement, because as I was reading the Sunday school book, I immediately went into the Joseph blessing. I believe Apostle Landrum from Florida came from Florida to minister to our leader at a tough and difficult time in his life. And he just gave him what God gave him regarding the vision that was for an appointed time. And I'm quite sure back then, nobody knew it was going to be years later that it would manifest. And to cut it down, it's also, I want to say that this is really like real important for us to really focus on, because one thing I've been seeing in the realm of the spirit with the house of Macedonia is that God gave a word, and the word is here now, but the timing of the word may, like, you already received your blessing last week. Somebody may receive it this week. Then somebody else may receive it another month from now. So I believe it's important for us to just hold on to what God has given us and just know that it will come to pass. And lastly, Joseph could not be the deliverer of the world if he was in Israel. It couldn't happen if he was at Potiphar's house. It's like everything is just as Sister Purdue said, it's a puzzle that has to be placed together, and then God will get the full glory out of a vessel's life.
Amen. And Brother Walter, my blessings is continual. It ain't a one-stop shop. Sister Janine.
Yes, I was going to say, just to answer your question, waiting is difficult. It's never easy. But I think, like you said earlier, we're learning to trust the process and really trust God's word, knowing that everything that he has said is not going to return to him void, but knowing that God always has our best interests, and that, you know, he has what's good for us. And so because he knows us best, he knows when and when not to do it. So we have to trust his sovereignty.
Amen. Great. Brother Isaac.
I think one example was David, and how his process and through perseverance and in regards to at his darkest hour and Ziklag, and how he encouraged himself in the Lord, like how Elder Wilkes preached quite a few times about, and at his darkest hour, his blessing was right around the corner, you know? So that's just another example.
Excellent. Thank you so much for sharing that. We'll get these last two hands, Brother Curtis and then Sister Miller.
Yeah, like Abraham, God gave him the promise about Isaac, and Abraham and Sarah got in a hurry and they made Ishmael because they weren't patient enough. Another thing, we had need of patience. In the time frame that we are now, we get everything instant. We get Wi-Fi, we get drive-through restaurants at McDonald's, microwave ovens, everything is instant. So we have a hard time now dealing with patience because everything is fast.
Good. Sister Millie?
I just want to be transparent on waiting. The second time, first I got married when I was a young lady, and then I got married in the church. And all the pastor told me was, Millie, don't get married now. Just wait. I did not wait. It was a nightmare for 4 years that I was married. And I tell the young people in Macedonia, wait, wait till the pastor says he gets a green light for your life with whatever man. Wait, because God does not make a mistake. And we have to learn how to wait. Like the young saints are saying, pray, stay in his presence. Don't let a human being that is not right come into your life. You don't need a nightmare in your life. You just need what God says. And usually God speaks to the man of God. Hallelujah. You know, and when I'm free, like I'm free right now, this is better than any husband that's not right for you. Bye.
Excellent. Excellent. I second that point. Amen. So what is the vision of Macedonia Church here in Norwalk, Connecticut? There's a few Macedonias in the state of Connecticut in this region. So I want to make sure that I'm clear. What is our vision? Can anybody tell us? All right, I'll help you out. Let me go with Dean. Let's see what you got to say, Dean.
I would say Elder Page, total deliverance, revival, and the catching up of our pastors and the great cloud of witness.
Okay. So let's look. I pulled this off of our website. This is what our website says. Going far beyond the call of duty, doing more than others expected is what excellence is all about. And it comes from striving, maintaining the highest standards, looking after the smallest detail, going the extra mile. Excellent means doing your very best in everything, in every way. Any thoughts on that? Any thoughts? Okay. It's good for you to know your vision and your mission of any organization that you bought into, that you're a part of. Sister Janine.
Looking at this, it makes me think that, you know, with this vision, we're not going to be mediocre as a ministry, but we're going to bring people into a deeper level of knowing God in every intricacy of our ministry, whether it's outreach, whether it's preaching the word of God. It's done with excellence, and that only is coming from being in the presence of God. So it makes me think of a higher level, a higher calling, being more than the norm.
Great. Thank you. Sister Kiwana and Sister Hart.
Yeah, I second that. I definitely second that. And I think you can see it actually happening in our church. And we are actually living up to this vision just by the way, you know, we carry ourselves, by the way that, you know, pastor instructs us to do things. And, you know, not throwing off on any other churches, but this church definitely carries itself in excellence. And you can definitely see that we're pushing for this vision, and you know, it's awesome.
Amen. And I would just add to that, you know, pastor been speaking about excellence for decades, right? Ever since the Lord gave him that. And now we're starting to hear it everywhere. You're starting to hear that in corporate, you're starting to hear it all over the place. People are trying to pursue excellence, but excellence is only given through the power of God. And that's what we have backing us up. Sister Hart, well said. Sister Hart?
Yes, I would agree with what Janine and Kiwana said. Definitely excellence, and that's just not words on a piece of paper, but that's actually, you know, our ministry. I've been in the part of the ministry now for 40 plus years, and it's been like that from the very beginning. So.
Good. Last one, Brother Ricky.
Yeah, it's pretty much what everybody said. It's just, you know, going above, doing like what we're doing, even with the food drive that we're doing now. And when it says one of the last things, you went past it, but one of the last things that it said in everything and in every way. So I just pretty much just took that then more than just, you know, preaching and, you know, doing a lot of things that a lot of the other churches are doing, preaching, prophesying, and that stuff is all good. But when it says, when I think of like in everything, you know, one of the prophetic words that's over our ministry is that we're going to be the head and not the tail. So I look at it as, you know, in everything, in our prayer life, and, you know, in the reading of our words, you know, we're going to be the best in that, especially when we get sent out in this next revival move. So
I love that. And you made me think about somebody recently said to me, everybody that I've talked to so far in your church, they were just so polite. They were just so welcoming. They were so warm, and they made me feel special. That's excellence. And how we conduct ourselves with even individuals out in our community. That's very important, because again, we're representing the House of Macedonia. We're representing God, obviously, number one, but we're also representing our leadership. Amen. Sister Sabrina, and we'll move on.
Just want to piggyback on what Brother Ricky was saying in regards to any call of duty when it comes to God. The strength has to be above and beyond with prayer, reading of your word, because then the Holy Ghost will guide you. You know, some people want to be in a pulpit. Some people want, and they're supposed to be at the door ushering. God will really guide. And sometimes we compartmentalize what's the best, but when God, the best could be the usher. So being able to have the excellence all about what God has you to do, it comes from having that relationship like Habakkuk has, to really be guided in the direction to go above and beyond and striving in what God will have us to do.
Amen. And a definition that goes along with what you're saying is, the vision ensures that all decisions are made properly aligned with what the organization, the church, hopes to achieve. Amen. So what is the mission? What is the mission of Macedonia Church? Let me bring that. I'm sure we don't know that by heart. I asked that at one of my jobs one time. Nobody out of 500 people knew the mission of the college. But we should know the vision and the mission, again, of any organization or any job that we're part of. When I was working at Stanford Hospital, on our ID badge, the front of it said the vision of the hospital and the back of it said the mission. So here we go, as a constant reminder of what we're doing. So our mission, it says on our website, is to birth, train, and empower disciples of Jesus Christ to impact the spiritual and temporal needs of our community and world. We strive to be compassionate in our love. We strive to do it. Amen. And excellence in our service, holy in our living, passionate and reverent in our worship. That's a Salah moment. Any thoughts? The purpose of a mission is to provide a clear and effective guide, again, for all decision-making, the things that we do within the four walls and without of the four walls. So now, no thoughts, we'll move on. Why is it important to write down your God-given vision? Why is knowing your God-given vision important for your, why is your knowing your God-given vision for the future important for you? Any thoughts out there? Does anybody have a God-given vision in your personal life? Sister Angel, Sister Tanaya.
Because we're lost without it. If we don't know, you know, where we're going, you know, if we don't know who we are, we don't know where we're going, we're just lost without it.
Good. Sister Tanaya and Sister Janine.
Sister Janine, we'll move on.
Yeah, just like Sister Angel said, but for me, it's like, you know, the carrot in front of the horse. You keep going straight and you won't veer off left or right because you have the vision right in front of your eyes. So you can't get lost because you know your final destination, where you're supposed to go and what's your end.
Good. I'm hoping I'm making you guys think out there. That's my job. I'm going to get Minister Brandon, Sister Merle, and then Sister Sonya.
When you asked that question, why is it important to write down your God-given vision? Because the scripture that came to me was faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And the only way we could have faith and to you know, believe, you know, through things that life and circumstances and to keep that vision clear is to hear from God. So that's what I think is important.
Good. Next.
I think that a vision is very important because it's like, a lot of times, even in business world, they have people to do vision boards, and it's something about visually seeing what you're believing God for, or what you're believing in. It's something about that visual piece that helps you to move forward. But then the other part about writing it down, it's just like a lot of people now talk a lot about declaring it. So it's like we declare and we decree the word. So when you have your vision, or if you get a prophecy, I often tell people it's important to write your prophecies down because you can always go back to it and you can read it. And sometimes that may even mean reading it and speaking it out loud, because as you do that, you are declaring it and you're decreeing it back unto God.
Excellent. You hit all of my points. Sister Sonia, Sister Perdue, Sister Janine, we'll end there.
Adding on to what Sister Merle said is it also, as we get older, we tend to forget. And we tend to, you know, what part of that is real? And when you write it down and you keep rehearsing it, I think it also builds our faith, but it reminds us of that promise that was given to us.
Yeah, yeah, good. Sister Perdue? And Sister Janine, you could fill in the gap while she tried to get her technology together.
Yeah, basically everyone said it, but I was going to say, like with the vision, obviously vision for us really should come from God, because oftentimes if we create our own vision, God's not really obligated to bless it. But like you said here in your PowerPoint, it provides a sense of direction and purpose. And I think, you know, with our vision, we want to fulfill the purpose that God has for our lives, because oftentimes we create vision boards and it could be out of our own lustful desires. It could be, you know, very materialistic things. But when God gives you a vision, he's going to bless it and he's going to give you the tools and the resources to carry out that vision with success.
I like that. You talked about the resources. We're going to hit on that a little bit coming up in one of these next few slides. Sister Perdue.
Yes, and also in view of everything everyone else is saying, for me, by writing it down, and sometimes you get so caught up with the things of life, not necessarily doing any sinning, but sometimes you be so consumed and being pulled in different directions, and you get, sometimes it can become overwhelming, and you had a tendency sometimes to just forget. But sometimes just reviewing or going over the prophecy or word given to you, whatever, it helps you refocus, to regroup, and to get yourself in a position that you need to do to move forward in a positive direction. That has worked for me.
Good. And lastly, Sister Nikki, we'll move on from this.
Just to support what everyone has said, Scripture, Proverbs 29 and 18, where there is no vision, the people perish.
That's good. That's good. I'm surprised I haven't thought about that scripture, but that's good. So how do I write a godly vision? Use the following questions. This is just for your own hearing and learning. Use the following questions to focus your vision statement. Do I feel God has purpose in my life? You gotta understand, like Sister Janine said, is it God driven? Is it purpose driven? Have you heard from the throne? And if there's something in your heart, there's nothing wrong with praying and saying, Lord, is this your will or is this just me? You know, regardless of your age, God has work for you to do. So we should continue to write down what it is that God has said that he would have us to do in this lifespan that he has allotted us to live out, right? God has work for you to do. I don't ever, and I reiterate this from Friday night, that yes, God is working on building up the younger generation, but each of us who have already been preaching and doing the will of God all of these years, whether we're in our 50s, 60s, or 70s, or even 80s, God still has a work for us to do. There's more than enough work, as I heard the preacher say last night, for each of us to do. And we should. So never get discouraged and think that, God, you forgot about me. Regardless of your situation, we heard Cynthia Welfare, I believe, said on Sunday. She said, I'm ready to go back and do what God told me to do now. I'm going back to school, grant right, whatever it is that God has put in her heart to help further the kingdom of God. Because at the end of the day, is it building the kingdom of God? Because only what we do for Christ is going to last. And what ways has God's hand been manifested in my life? That kind of will show you and kind of lead and direct you and kind of give you some insight, if you can't figure it out, where God is taking you in his purpose and plan for your life. For example, we saw that David was working with the sheep. That was preparing him and Moses to become shepherds, just to give a brief example. So here we have it. What brings me joy or satisfaction? Do I love what I do? Man, they say, Paige, you're doing so much. How do you have time? Because everything that I do, I love. So when there's something that is passionate, when there's something that you love doing, our pastor loves God. He loves leading a church. He loves doing what he's been called to do from generations before he was even born and even knew what God was going to call him to do. It makes it easy when you love doing what you're doing and you have get satisfaction out of it, without mixing up my words here. Now, moving right along. How, we'll get your hands, Sister Nikki. Number five, answer. You got a comment, you can answer it and, you know, make a comment.
Okay, so before you move on to the condemnation or judgment, I got to commend you, Elder Kyle, because while I was studying this lesson, I thought about you and how you faithfully served the church, how you faithfully committed to your wife, how you're faithfully committed to the university, and how you led out this whole multitude of students. And it's because of you that I have even gone on to pursue my doctorate and Elder Michelle's confirmation. So I really got to commend you, because this takes a lot. Like, I just researched one question and I was like exhausted. And here you go and you do this on top of leading out a university, on top of leading out a multitude, you know, of people. And as everyone has said, I mean, the mission and the vision, it definitely is an extension that's seen in our lives. So I really do commend you. And thank you again for the recommendation for my doctorate of health science.
Thank you, Sister Nikki. I appreciate that. And it's true. You made me think about it. I hate the joke behind that comment, but I have to. Sister Tanea let the cat out of the bag that I assigned. I asked individuals to take a question. Nobody don't take my people that's been answering questions. Now, we got more than enough people to use in this church. You know, y'all leave my readers and my prayer people alone. That's my joke for the Bible study teachers. anyways. So I went around and I found 10 people, and one person reached out to me today and said, I can't do it. And it just reminded me of the college students. My father fell off a crane. I didn't do my homework, because it's a lot. It really does require a lot to answer these questions. So I thank God. That's your treat for tonight. You're hearing from a lot of people that we don't normally hear from, because I actually went to those type of people and try to motivate them to participate tonight by giving them the question 3 or 4 days in advance. And all of you have stepped up to the plate. Shy that one that called out on me this morning, but they're good. They're good. So number 5, how would the Lord punish the Chaldeans for their insatiable conquest in general and morality? Sister Denise.
He would bring disaster upon them from the very people they had conquered and dominated. God was using them to chastise Judah. However, they went too far. They started to take territory and conquer people that didn't belong to them.
All right, good. Thank you, Sister Denise. You being one of those ones. I'm proud of you too, Sister Denise. Thank you. Oh, so now, next question. Why was it important for those in Habakkuk's day to live by faith? Minister Dean.
Elder Paige, Shania here laughing at me because she know I was up. It was important for those in Habakkuk's days to have faith because of what was going on in the land. Habakkuk and God, people are seeing wickedness, violence, strife, injustice, oppression of the righteous in the land. It was important to keep the faith because God had a plan of using Chaldeans to invade the land. It will take faith. Although it looked like God wasn't punishing evil, he also had a plan. It will also take time for faith for his plan to come into effect. Habakkuk also knew he was safe no matter what was going on to happen. He knew he would live by his faith and join the fullness of God, presence, and security. And while I was reading, writing this down and researching it, for some reason this jumped into my spirit. For example, today, overturning Roe versus Wade, his plan took 50 years. First, he had to put the right judges in the Supreme Court, like Beckett and Kavanaugh. Then the seeds had to be planted to overthrow the abortion law. God used the same Supreme Court that made abortion legal and used the same court to abolish it, just like he used the Chaldeans to bring wrath down to Judah so the righteous could have justice.
I like that. I like how you tied that into current events. Sister Kwana, Sister Angel, then Sister Sabrina, we'll move on.
Yeah, I think because faith is such a cornerstone of just our Christian walk. It's so important and it's just needed to be weaved into sort of everything that we do as a Christian. Faith will keep your mind in times of calamity. It'll keep you with joy, even when things are going crazy around you. Just real quick, I remember when the earthquake happened in Haiti back in 2011, Isaac went there to help out. And he said the place was wrecked, like nobody had homes, everything was leveled, there was nothing. But he said the people had such faith that they were still singing hymns on the street. They didn't have no home to go to. They didn't have, you know, a proper bathroom to go to. There was diseases all around. But he literally said they were holding hands and singing hymns because they had faith in their God. So faith is so important.
Wow. Beautiful. Sister Angel, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. My answer is similar anyway. But it was just saying that it was just like
in today's day, we don't see, it looks like devastation in every area. And when I first got saved, there was no way I thought that they would overturn Roe versus Wade. I just never thought it. And I know even in that, in the Supreme Court overturning it, we still have a long way to go in that. But I never thought that that day would come. But I would say maybe about a few years ago, where was my faith really increased. And I was like, no, revival is coming. Roe versus Wade will be overturned. So just like they needed it back then, we definitely need it today.
Hey, man, I got to say this because of the residue of what Sister Kwana said. I asked Sister Kwana to read for me the last time I taught Sunday Bible study. And I tell you, Sister Kwana has not, she says she hasn't looked back. From that one time, and this is just my personal observation, from that one time she read that Bible study, the lesson text, and was reading for me last Bible study, man, she's just been on a mission moving forward. You could just feel a sweet anointing coming from her ever since. So Sister Kwana, hold on to what you got. Keep doing whatever you're doing. You're in a good place. You're in a really good place. God got something great for you if he's anointing you like that in the midst of having a brand new serious job. Sister Sabrina, and then Brother Curtis.
I just want to confirm what you're saying in regards to Kwana. I am really enjoying you, Kwana. I really am enjoying you. The other thing is, when you talk about that question, when you think about Hebrews 1:11-1, it says, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. The Babylonians was ruthless. The Chaldeans was ruthless. So when you're looking at them, I mean, they will rip babies out of your stomach and all types of stuff. When you're looking at what he was going through at that time, what they were going through, you really have to have faith in knowing that God is going to work it out. In spite of what you're looking for at that moment, you just have to know without a shadow of a doubt that he was going to bring the Judah and all of them out of that. So thinking about that, you have to know that you know.
Wow, good. Brother Curtis?
Yeah, Hebrews, the 11th chapter, speaks of faith and speaks of all of the people in the Bible, significant ones who walked in faith and what they overcame by walking in faith. So this is the foundation of faith. And then along with that, this scripture here in Habakkuk is one of the foundational scriptures to Macedonia. And we take this scripture and use it all the time when we talk about division, when we talk about patience, and we talk about waiting on it. So this is one of our foundational scriptures as a ministry.
Yeah, thank you so much. I just want to read this note that I have on the screen here, and I'm gonna take my time reading it for a purpose. It says, behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith. The words his soul refers to the Chaldeans in general. As a people, they were lifted up, meaning puffed up and full of pride. Like the Chaldeans, the person who is proud trusts in his or her own limited resources instead of recognizing God's unfailing strength. And it's amazing because the Bible talks about how the preacher, the teacher, those that go forth ministering to other people, we are first partakers of God's word. And yesterday, as I've been preparing this lesson for a little while, but yesterday I really was digging a little bit further into it. And I had shared something with one of the saints. And then I opened up the Sunday school book and read this particular thing I'm reading to you. And the Lord immediately corrected me. Immediately, he showed me my error in highlighting resources. And I really believe he used me to be the first partaker of that. As we're in this finest hour and the resources are going to increase in our lives, God wants us to make sure that we are not giving anybody else any glory other than himself. It's not the resources. He is the resource. He will allow people to come into our paths that will be conduits of the blessings, but at the end of the day, it's God. Amen. So I just wanted to just plug that in there, that anything else is limited, but God has no limit or restriction on being our resource. So I just wanted to plug that in there. Any thoughts on that before I move on? Brother Isaac.
Yeah, sometimes when I struggle with faith, I always think of the word and just trusting in the word and word alone, and that I don't trust in chariots, I don't trust in horses, and I don't trust in man, but I only trust in the word of God, and it will not return void. And like David, I never seen the righteous forsaken and the seed for begging bread. And I just trust and just in God alone, and God being the source of all, for he pours on the just and the unjust, for he is a source and the provider for all. You know, so I just look at that and that he is the ultimate source, and just look at supply chain, that he is, you know, he is a provider. He is the supply. He's a source, and everything else, you know, and just like Laban, you know, and he will change the heart and move the heart of Laban to bless the, you know, the just. So I look at that, you know, that's all.
No, that's good, and we'll put that plug in you while we're talking about vision, and we're talking about you got to hit your Kawana, your mic is on. While we're talking about vision and what God has said, I just want to remind you, because I've been thinking about it a lot over the last few weeks, Brother Isaac, that God gave you a word that you would be a pastor in Haiti, and I still believe that word. I just to hear that you and your wife went over to Haiti to work, I wasn't aware of that. I knew you did. I didn't realize both of you went. But yeah, God has a word over your life, and I'm looking forward to coming to that church and seeing you preach the gospel of Jesus Christ with fire and power. Amen. Sister Janine.
Yeah, I was just thinking too, the scripture that says, when we're talking about resources and not trusting ourselves, that all good and perfect gifts come from God above, and just knowing that, you know, he's the source. He's the one that when he gives a vision, he's the one that makes provision. And so, you know, we always give him glory and honor, because we know man will fail, but with God, you'll never fail, because Amen. You're trusting in him.
Amen. Amen. Good. Brother Curtis, last.
Yeah, I just wanted to say, in reference to it's our finest hour, I was thinking about Solomon. And when Solomon asked God only for wisdom in order that he could rule the people, God blessed Solomon and told Solomon he was going to give him more than that. And God blessed Solomon. Solomon, the Queen of Sheba came to Solomon, said, I never seen it, and they didn't tell it the way that I saw it. So she came bearing gifts. Solomon got gold, he got silver, he got beasts, he got the wood in order that he could build the church. God supplied Solomon with every single thing that Solomon needed. Solomon was just fully rich in the kingdom. And I believe that our leader is a type of Solomon, that people are going to come from everywhere with the coin in the fish's mouth, and they're going to give unlimited resources, unlimited things to build the church up with, and finances that we can't even count yet.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for sharing that. I thought it was this. I came across this today from Charles Spurgeon. I thought it was good to share. I'll read it, because the print is kind of small. It says, pride the destroyer. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright of him, but the just shall live by faith. Here is a man who says that he is absolutely perfect. Does he know what the sin of pride really is? What prouder being can there be than one who talks like that? Oh, but he says, I'm humble. Is there any soul living that is so proud as to say he is humble? Is not the same acme and climax of pride? Another says, I hate flattery. It's all pride in disguise. Why? That is the worst kind of pride. Only it has put on the sheepskin instead of coming out in its true wolfish garb. So again, this really hit me, that even in the midst of our finest hour, we have to continue to make sure that we are walking and seeking, because I don't think any of us have arrived there yet, but we're walking and seeking and praying, Lord, give me the spirit of humility as you bless me. So, number 7, what role did wine have in the fall of Babylon? Sister Teresa.
From my study, I went to Daniel 5 and Belshazzar. Mm-hmm. He had a lot of pride in him. He was the king. And he commanded that they bring the gold and silver vessels that his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple of the house of God. And he drunk wine, because the vessels was sacred, and he drunk wine out of them. So that was like, that's how Babylon fell, because he had a lot of pride in him, and he thought it was all about him instead of about God.
Very good. And I just wrote to add to that, in the book of Daniel, we see how strong drink led to their own demise. Great. Thank you so much. How were the Chaldeans ambitious for conquest like death? Sister Nikki.
Okay, Elder Kyle, this is about 270 words.
I researched this thoroughly. I went through 5 different commentators, and I went with Bible Hub, Barnes Notes on the Bible. But first, let me give you what our text states on page 36. It says, he enlargeth his desire as hell and is as death and cannot be satisfied. The Chaldean's conquest is compared to death in that it is insatiable or impossible to satisfy. Bible Hub, Barnes Notes on the Bible states, Isaiah 5:14, hell hath enlarged her soul and opened her mouth beyond measure. As hell, which is insatiable, he saith, enlargeth, for as hell and the grave are year by year fuller, yet there is no end. The desire enlargeth and becometh wider, the more it's given to it to satisfy it. So this next part is really important. So focus, because this is applying to the Babylonians' defeat. And he is himself as death, oh, sparing none. This would speak of a destroyer as being like the angel of death, his presence as the presence of death itself. Where he is, there is death. He is as terrible and as destroying as the death which follows him and cannot be satisfied. So bringing it into today, and speaking of Judah's restoration, this is not for the faithful who live by faith and who abide in God's presence, but for the Chaldean who is ensnared by the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life.
Wow. Very, very, very good. Thank you so much. Moving right along. The prophet's trust. How would the agricultural economy of Judah be affected by the Chaldean invasion? Sister Michelle Page.
Yes. Thank you, Sister Nikki. I love that background knowledge. I read a lot of that content myself. So if we consider what Sister Nikki said, just picture giving your keys to your home with all of your food and all of your belongings to the Chaldeans, what your house would look like. Okay. They would totally strip everything. Not care about the formula for your baby, not care about the fact that you are pregnant, not care about anything because of the fact that they are a destroyer. And the unfortunate thing about the people of God, once they've turned their back on God, is God, he deals with us in a way, it's a process. He takes a little at a time. And the reason why he does that, it's a constant, pinch. It's a constant, come on, let's get ourselves together. And if we don't take heed, he comes out with great wrath. So the condition of Israel, based on them being placed into the hands of the Chaldeans, think about it. It was so bad that children, would govern over them. People, adults were going to their relatives saying, please, please be our king. Please give us food. They had nothing to give them. All food was gone. They were ruled by babies. They could not even expect respect elders. Everything in terms of, just their well-being was totally, totally wiped away. And that's the result of the evil Chaldeans.
Yeah. And I would just add to that. Thank you so much. And you're right. Both answers were very in-depth and comprehensive. Fear gripped the prophet. He saw economical crisis that was imminent. And that's what we've been hearing from the true prophets, that there's an economical crisis that is imminent. But God has given the people of God wisdom what to do in this hour and this time. So it's very important to pay attention to what the Lord is saying to do in this finest hour with your wealth as well. Now, perseverance of faith. What is the key finding in the midst of suffering? We're moving on to chapter 3, focusing on the praise in the midst of suffering. What is the key to finding joy in the midst of suffering? Anybody? It was the key to finding joy in the midst of suffering. I'll just add that there's no answer on the floor. Let me try you, Sister Merle.
On and trust in God.
I'm sorry, one more time.
To focus on and trust in God.
Amen. Good. Sister Linda?
Basically what Sister Merle said, trust God and just look at all he has done in the past. And most of all, that he is in control. And he always does what's best.
Amen. So the question is, that comes to my mind right now, it's not something that I had planned to ask. Has anybody suffered as a Christian? Has anybody suffered as an evildoer? No, just joking. But has anybody suffered as a Christian? And during your times of suffering, what did you do? And you don't have to answer that on this platform tonight, but I just want you to think about it. For me, in times of suffering, I got to keep myself doing what I know to do. That's praying, spending time in God's presence, not pulling back, but continually to move forward, because there's only two directions you're going to go. Either you're going to draw closer to God in the midst of your suffering, or you're going to withdraw from God in the midst of your suffering. And a lot of times the people that withdraw are the people that tend to go back to their vomit. So that's why the Bible talks about not backsliding and going back to your vomit, because they've taken their eyes off of God and they go back to doing those things that appease their flesh to get them through the suffering of when they were in the world. So it's important that we practice daily having that relationship with the Lord, practice daily having a discipline in a lifestyle of spending quality time with God, giving him his portion first every single day, tithing our portion, our 10% up front to him every single day. And then when trials come, suffering come, you're already in that space. You're already just going to continue to do what you're doing, and you may have to step it up, but you'll continue to do what you're doing. And in the case that you don't have the strength to do what you need to do, God knows he'll give you the strength to move forward. Amen. So to what animal did Habakkuk liken himself? Question number 10, the last question in our book. Minister Dean.
Hi, it's Tanya.
Hey, sister.
It was a deer.
Amen.
And I just want to elaborate a little bit on that.
Please do.
I looked up the deer, his feet. That was important, because a deer's feet can grip and to bear down when it needs to run or jump high. Their legs are really strong. And I started thinking about that, and I said, Lord, you know, I want you to make me like that deer, where when problems come, when things come, I can grip down and do what I need to do. And that is prayer. Our hind feet is the prayer, our faith, and letting the Holy Spirit guide us.
Good. Thank you so much. Brother Curtis, I'll get you at the end of this. I'm about to just, you'll have a spot in a second. So for those of us, I just want to put this plug in. When I first came to Macedonia, this book was highly encouraged to read. So those of us who are new, or those of us who have never, or maybe not be a part of this ministry, we have to remember we're not just talking to Macedonia anymore. There's a book called Hind Feet on High Places by Hannah Hernad. It is a fantastic book, and it aligns totally with the scriptures. It's a biblical-based book, and it will bless your soul. So I encourage you to read it. Some of us may need to go back and reread it. Pastor asked me recently about this book, and I said, yeah, but I could remember some of the stuff that I read. I just remember she finally did get to the high places, and she has some crazy cousins. But we should go back and read it. Here goes some of our key takeaways. The Lord promises often require patience, but they do not require revision. Man, that's huge, because we're living in a day of time where culture is trying to tell us we need to revise our vision. We need to revise our mission. We need to change and become as the world, but we're not even going to go there tonight. But I just want to put that out there. God's people must follow him by faith, for they do not know all the answers. The worst conditions of this life cannot rob us of the joy of our salvation. Man, David said, restore unto me the joy of our salvation. I don't know why I felt the Holy Ghost on that sit on my neck the moment I started reading that. Somebody, God is restoring your joy tonight, just of being saved, being glad of where he brought you from. That's the joy of our salvation. Our worst condition can't rob us of that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The reason Habakkuk could rejoice irrespective of his future is because he knew that God was his strength. He had personal relationship with God. David had personal relationship while he penned it for the saints, that the Lord is my strength. The Lord is my fortress. Amen. The deer have the strength that Sister Tanya said, and thank you again, Sister Tanya. I know you're glad that you did do your research. The deer has the strength to leap from height to height, unhindered by the circumstances below. And when you begin to see some of the clips that you can find on YouTube, it's amazing how they could scale some of these mountainsides and get all the way up to the top, but nothing below them is phasing them. Now, afflictions are designed on the part of God to produce positive results in the lives of God's people. We have to know that, as Dr. Hines, Brother Tyler said, that our all things are working together for the good to them that love the Lord, to them that are called according to his purpose. Amen. And for those of you who don't know, I believe Tyler's going to be some type of doctor one day. So that's been his nickname since he was a baby, Dr. Hines. Everything that happens to be a believer is either caused or allowed by the Lord. Consequently, we should learn the lesson desired to be taught. For whom the Lord loves, them he chastens. So now, with our last 5 minutes, Brother Curtis, if there's anybody who wants to add to this lesson, we'll give you opportunity. We have a little bit of space, which I knew that this would end early enough, which is why I took all of your hands tonight and really enjoyed each and every single one of you. I know it was a treat to the house of God tonight to hear a lot of you that we haven't really heard from before. And I continue to encourage you, continue to just do what you need to do. Take that same space, dig into the scriptures. If you just got to study one question a week, a day as we lead up to the Bible study, trust me, you will not regret it by the time you come to these Wednesday night with these Bible study teachers. You'll be glad that you did. Amen. Brother Curtis, before we go, is there something you wanted to share?
Yeah, and I'm glad that I did tune into this Bible study, because I certainly enjoyed you. I enjoyed the lesson. I enjoyed how you opened up the word to us, not only you, but all other teachers. So my hat's off to you.
To God be all the glory. I do want to leave a dream and a thought with you all that I had today. And those of you that are able to discern, you take what it from what you get out of it. I'll just share the dream. So in this dream, this morning, I lay down and just took a quick nap. The saints were together, and I began to encourage the saints to get excited and to demonstrate their excitement, because there was onlookers, there were people who wasn't a part of the ministry who were watching in, and God was calling for an excitement. The purpose of it, as I just said, was for souls being drawn to the excitement of the saints. You know, we can have a narrative. I'm not saying that this is a narrative, but there's a possibility that we can have a narrative right now that people are just dying in Macedonia church. Don't go to that church. Or people over there are experiencing so much death. That's a sad church. That's a depressed church. But God doesn't want us to be in the midst of our suffering, as we heard tonight. He doesn't want us to become a depressed or sad church. He wants us to be an excited church. People are not drawn to a sad or depressed part. And I'm not saying that we've had been, nor am I saying that we've demonstrated. I'm just sharing the dream to what the Lord gave me today and wanted me to share tonight. So people are not, as I said, they're not drawn to a sad party. So God wants us to increase our praise and our excitement about just being saved, as we just talked about, the joy of our salvation in the midst of our suffering, in the midst of the pressures, in the midst of the fight. But I also noticed that Pastor in his dream was extremely tired. He was extremely tired in this dream, but he was able to glean strength, because the saints immediately began to get excited and praise God just upon the request that I put out there. And it was a unified praise. Immediately, a pastor began to gain strength. And as well, myself, I didn't have a whole lot of strength. I began to gain strength. And that was the crux of the dream. So I just wanted to put that out there, put it on record. A, for the purpose, if nothing else, let's pray for our pastor. He's been going nonstop lately, and I'm sure he's human. He has to be tired. So let's pray for his strength, and let's pray one for another. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you once again tonight just for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. Just join in with me for a few seconds, saints, as we close with the benediction. Lord, we just thank you tonight for your grace and your mercy, for your loving kindness, how you have spoken to our hearts, Lord, how you have ministered to us. And Lord, we recognize that we can't do this in our own self. We can't do this in our own strength. But Lord, we recognize, like Habakkuk on tonight, we need you to be our strength. And we trust and believe that you will strengthen us, that you will strengthen our pastor, that you will give him what he needs to move forward in this part of the journey and this chapter in his life. Have your mighty way. We thank you for this house. We thank you for how you're ministering to us on a daily basis. whether it's corporately or even personally, Father. And we just pray, even as we read this lesson, as we talked about it, as we broke bread, as we fellowshiped as iron sharpened iron on tonight, that you will burn the vision in our hearts. Burn the vision and the mission of Macedonia Church in our souls. And as we come together and we begin to step out into the community and distribute and do all of the things that you're calling us to do, let everything be done with the spirit of excellence. And we'll be careful to give your name the praise. We'll be careful to give you the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, God bless you. Have a good night. Thank you again for all those that participated and joined us and will join us in the future. Amen. God bless you.
Listen, for those of you that are going through, for those of us that are waiting on his promise, understand God has not forgotten you. When times get tough, you got to look up to heaven and encourage yourself and say, just like an eagle and soar, they shall run and not be weary. Walk never vain. Thank God with on the Lord. And I say, what? Hold on a little while longer. Here's what you gotta do. Just believe. He'll work it over. You everything you must remember. My God is able and he cares for you. Come on and say, let's say it like this.
Wait on the Lord and he will come through. Wait on the Lord and he will answer you. Wait on the Lord.
Just like an eagle and soar, they shall run and not be weary, never faint. Faith that wait on the Lord. And I say, what? Now go tell somebody you're close to. Here's. Just tell them this. He'll
get up for you. One thing you must remember. My God is able and cares.
Care for you, yeah.
Wait on the Lord.
Upon him shall every new spring, yeah. And shall mount upon wings
like eagles
that soar.
Go ahead, tell them how you feel.
And someday,
I'm so glad
I learned how to wait. In the midst of my waiting, I'm gonna bless you every day.
They shall mount up on wings like an eagle that soars.
They shall walk that little way
and wait.
Wait
on the Lord.
Let me see you break it down with me. What? Let me see you break it down with me. Wave your hands and shake your head. Stomp your feet and tell your neighbor. Hold on. Hold on. I'm telling you to hold on. Just a little while. say, he don't say, know that you can. You've been praying for.
You got to hear it.
All your job to turn around, say,
got to listen.
No.